AI is definitely changing our society and will be changing our society. That's also why we need to keep the pace with the ethics as well. And ethics of artificial intelligence, that's the topic for the next speaker, who is the CEO of GoodAI, a general artificial intelligence R&D company that has a robotic owl in its logo. It's supposed to say that this is the symbol of wisdom as well as a symbol of a message saying you don't have to worry about AI. It will help you out. Ladies and gentlemen, Marek Rosa. Thank you for coming. Are you a space engineer?
Yes, sometimes, when I play our games.
Tell us the story. Because he is the space engineer, and thanks to him, you all can be space engineers.
In our game. So basically, I was dreaming about general AI since my childhood, and back then, it was maybe 20 years ago, I didn't really see the path towards AI by going to university or studying AI or something like this, so I, because I wanted to be more free. So I, because I also loved developing games, I started a game company here in Prague, and after some time, we were able to get successful, and I was able to start GoodAI and have a research company for general AI.
Thanks to this game, space engineers, you can try to build a small colony on asteroids, for example. Mm-hmm. Depends on your skills and your wishes you have. But now we will concentrate on ethics of AI. Marek, please, go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you. So in my talk, I will talk about what is AI, what is actually intelligence. I will talk about how can we make AI to be good. And I will also talk a little bit about how we are, how I see the future. What is artificial intelligence or what is intelligence? So we, in our company, we define intelligence as a tool for searching for solutions to problems. And here I would like to emphasize the word search. Because if you know a solution for some problem, you just execute the steps that lead you to the solution. But if you don't know the solution, and this is where intelligence comes handy, you need to search in some possible space of possible solutions for the right solution. Or if you cannot create the solutions, you actually need to start enlarging this space of possible solutions. Or you can start diversify your search or narrow your search into location where it's more probable that you will find a solution. So this is basically what any intelligence is doing. And today, as Michal Pechuček has said, we have narrow AI or specialized AI or vertical AI. And it's AI that is good, that is specialized to solve some particular well-defined task. And it's usually the intelligence of this AI is stored in the brain or experience of the developer or researcher who created this bot. Because these AIs are really specified only for particular tasks and cannot go outside of these tasks. And for example, in GoodAI, we also have GoodBot, which is a chatbot that can communicate in Slovak language with customers and so on. Or there are other AIs like Siri or recommendation systems or self-driving cars and so on. And also one important thing about narrow AI is that how to evaluate how some narrow AI is good, it's always about how good it is at performing a particular task. So if it is AI that is recognizing something on images, you will say that it's good if it's making less errors than some other AI. So this is the way how to evaluate narrow AI. And the disadvantages of narrow AI is that it cannot learn gradually, it doesn't learn like a child, it cannot transfer skills from one domain to another domain, and so on. And for these reasons, we are developing, or we want to develop general AI. And it's also important to mention that general AI doesn't exist yet, but we have general intelligence, human, we people, we actually are quite general in our intelligence. And the difference between general and narrow AI is that general AI will be, general AI will be learning gradually, which means that it will be gradually accumulating one skill, one experience after another. This is probably general AI.
We were hacked. Where is Pablo's? We will figure it out.
Yeah.
What's showing in here? No signal. No signal. Perfect. That's great. How are you doing?
Good, good.
If we had AI, what would AI do right now?
Probably solve it somehow.
Pardon? Solve it somehow.
Yeah. Find solution.
Yeah, we have damn good people working on it.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because this seems that we have lost the signal connecting the big screen as well as the presentation computers that are connected directly to always, not only the screens in here, but also naturally on the big screen. But we will give it a second to find the solution. Please tell me, you were starting to talk about the general AI.
Yes, yes. So the other difference between narrow and general AI is that general AI accumulates skills.
Yep.
It will be able to transfer experience from one domain to another. It will be able to use what it learned to learn another things more efficiently.
What's the bottleneck of this process right now?
That's a good question, and I think the biggest one is this graduality. So today, when we have AI, we usually train it on one specific task, and we cannot transfer it somewhere else. Or when we want to teach this AI something new, we basically destroy its current intelligence, and we need to start over. So it's not really accumulating the skills, and every time you need to start from scratch.
And the reason is, because of the amount of data, of the amount of the data, or the complexity of the data?
I think the reason is the algorithms. The algorithms we currently have are not enough. They are good when you have a lot of data, and now I'm simplifying, but they are good for a specific task when you have a lot of data. That's good for narrow AI today. But when you actually want to use what you already learned, where you want to use what the AI already learned, mm-hmm. to transfer it and learn new stuff, new skills efficiently, that's what we don't have, these algorithms. And for example, one thing that may help us with this is, it's called meta-learning or recursive self-improvement. So it's an ability to actually learn how to learn. So mm-hmm. the AI will not be learning through the algorithm that we designed, that we programmed, but AI will actually discover better learning algorithms. And again, better learning algorithms. And if it will go recursively, this AI will be becoming better and so on. So
and you would have to spend less time on these improvements.
Yes, yes.
So it would be more effective and more efficient as well.
Exactly.
Perfect. The human intelligence prepared the AI back on the screen.
Yeah.
So let's go on, please.
Thank you. And so the ultimate goal with general AI is basically to get to human-level intelligence or human-level skill set and then go beyond. And the reason why general AI is so interesting for me and for us is that we can use it as a leverage for everything else. So instead of trying to invent better medicine, better spaceships, better programming, better this or that, I think for me it's better to focus on general AI, solve general AI, and then use for solving all these other things. For me, it's like ultimate scalability tool. And I don't think we need to be worried about general AI because general AI will be still just a tool. It will be just propagating the values we teach it or we encode to this AI. And there can be even bigger risks than AI itself, and for example, people. And we are talking and in our company and discussing a scenario that is called AI race. So basically, the idea is that there are multiple actors who know that general AI is a really good target, and they want to be there, they want to have it first. And when they will be racing for who will get it first, there can be some dangerous situation happening. And for example, one of them can be that the people who want to have this general AI first will race so fast that they will neglect the safety. So they will work on the capabilities of the AI, how intelligent it is, but they will neglect how safe it is, if it is actually propagating the beneficial values and so on. Another risk that can happen here is that someone will create this general AI as first, but it will not be available for the other people. So it can be a situation where you have first mover, and this first mover is moving so fast that the others cannot catch up, and basically the inequality will even grow even more. So we started a challenge in our company, and people can join this, try to solve this challenge, and basically the point of this challenge is to propose solutions how to mitigate this AI race scenario. Not to avoid it completely, because we cannot avoid it. Basically everything in this universe is racing with everything else, but maybe we can learn how to mitigate the race, to understand race dynamics, and turn them into something that can then lead to positive future for all of us. And I will talk about how to make AI good. So basically, what is AI? AI is something that is accumulating biases, positive or negative, but it's some skills, some biases, some heuristics. And then the AI is propagating these biases through its action to environment, to itself, and so on. And so what we need from AI, we need AI that will understand the world in the same way as we people understand. This is the question of explainability, for example. We also need to identify what are the values that we want this AI to have, what are the beneficial values for us. And then we need to train the AI to actually have these values. And finally, of course, we need to test the AI, that the AI has the values and will behave as we want, even in situations that we didn't expect or we didn't plan for, and so on. And the question of identifying our own values is tricky, because sometimes even ourselves, we cannot say what are our values until we are in some situation. So you all know this trolley problem. And you can ask yourself, if you will turn the switch and the train will kill 5 people or just 1 person. And now the question is, for example, what if those 5 people are someone who you don't know, but the 1 person is someone from your family, and so on and so on. So all these situations are very complex, not black and white. And again, even we people don't know how to, what are our values. So I think this will be first problem, but again, we can look around us, we can use the law and regulations as a source for discovering what are our values. Another challenge, of course, will be how to get these values to the AI so that the AI can propagate these values through its actions. And here we think it will be first some values need to be hard-coded, and then the other values will be learned through training environments, training tasks. And we will need to design very good training tasks so that the AI really learns the values that we want it to learn. And if you look on intelligence, as I said in the beginning, as something that is propagating the values, it will be propagating the values of the person or of the people who created the AI. And then you can also look on what are the right values or what do you think is the best value system there can be. And this leads to question, what is the criteria, how to evaluate which value system is better than some other. And we think that, for example, one way how to talk about this is which value system is better at propagating itself, at surviving, at getting forward into the future. And you can see the picture with Jesus and Christianity. And actually, I think it's a good example because Christianity is a value system that survived 2,000 years, even after the originator of this value system is not here anymore. And this value system is still propagating itself. I'm not saying if it is good or wrong, but the value propagation quality of Christianity is very well. There are some other value systems or some other cultures that just disappeared in the time because they were not willing to propagate themselves or they were so much in conflict with the rest of the environment that they had no chance to propagate themselves. And this leads us to what will the future look like. And I don't know exactly, of course, but I have some predictions and I think it will be complex. And I think we need to be thinking long term, even though if we are not sure about how this long term future will turn out, I still think it can have a lot of influence of our current actions that we can do today. So one question, for example, is jobs. And the traditional schema or traditional way how people think about this is that intelligence or AI robots will replace first the manual work, then the intellectual work, and then basically everything. I think it will be, of course, a little bit more complex. So I think AI will reduce some jobs or remove some jobs. So people will stop doing those jobs because AI will automate those things. But also AI will augment many existing jobs. And while we still will have just the narrow AI, we will need people to go to places where the AI still cannot function because it's not general enough. It doesn't have human level skill set or human values and so on. So people will be important and useful for augmenting the AI. And there will be also new jobs that are not possible or that there were not possible without AI. An example I can give you is, for example, programmers. We didn't have programmers 100 years ago, web designers or space engineers. None of these jobs basically existed 100 years ago and we have them now. So I think AI will enable these new kind of jobs. I cannot predict what it will be, but I think it will be interesting. And finally, I think this will lead us to the situation where we will have general AI, and if our predictions are correct, general AI will be really better at every job than any other person. And general AI will automate basically all jobs. And in this situation, you can start asking yourself, then why will companies employ people if they can just use AI and AI will do stuff? So I think that's first step. Another step is then companies will start asking themselves, why do we need to sell products and services to people if they can give us money, but we actually don't need the money because we don't need to buy anything from these people? So I think in this situation, what can happen is that the economy of people can split into people who have general AI, or the companies who have general AI, and people who don't have. And of course, it doesn't need to be so black and white, so there can be some catch-up. People who don't have general AI can get to this know-how, they can have general AI later and so on. So maybe it will not be so dark and black and white. Another thing that can happen, and it's also very interesting, is that I think the states, countries, can actually start serving as some machines for providing services for their citizens. And I think the way I want to explain is that today you need labor, know-how, and natural resources to deliver some services. But in the future, if you don't need the labor because you have AI, you have the AI, you have the know-how, and you also have resources because you are the country, you know, like you own the place. So you can combine these three things together and basically provide free services to people, to citizens in your country, without needing them to pay taxes or to give something in return. It's something like an example is sun or atmosphere or other things where there are some machines, like sun is some kind of machine that is generating light and energy, sending it to our planet. We are using it, but we are not paying back. You know, we are just using it. We're like basically these gatherers from the history who are just taking stuff that the nature is providing and not giving anything back. And we can get to similar situation. So in the end, I think, as I said, the future of AI depends on the people that will create it and what kind of values they will put to this AI, and the AI will be propagating these values to the future. Thank you.
Marek, Petra Skachová is asking, what do you think love would look like if it was created and felt by an artificial intelligence subject? In the future, she says, we will come to that. How would it look like?
So if the AI is feeling love?
Yeah.
Well, depends on how you train it. How you train it to feel love. I think that's the question.
So would it be the combination of ones and zeros?
In some way, even we are ones and zeros, you know. So, for example, I would say it like this. We were programmed by evolutions, by millions of years of evolution to feel love. And if we can replicate this process in training the AI, then I would say that the AI would feel also love. It will be probably slightly different way, but for me, it would be equal.
I have to say, you are kind of taking the emotion out of love.
I still think it will be there. Just like I feel the emotions through, let's call it programs that the evolution put to me through millions of years of the process, I think the AI can also feel or have the assumption or the feeling of feeling the emotions just like I do.
Says Marek Rosa. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Marek. Thank you.